And now, representing the distaff side of film editing, we have the lovely young lady who I met at EditFest this past year and a graduate of Manhattan Edit Workshop and a working editor. It's Jamie Unruh. Hey, Jamie.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Okay. We go to a lot of plays together and stuff.
We do. We know each other well.
We saw Porgy and Bess together.
I know. It was amazing.
Awesome.
Yeah. It was so good. I've made a good friend.
I was telling you that, you know, the theater is almost never that good.
Yeah.
That's the way it's
supposed to be. It was phenomenal. You could tell the audience was really loving it, too.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. It's one of the best things I've ever seen.
Yeah.
Beautiful, beautifully sung, beautifully acted.
Yeah.
Very, very good production. One of the American classics. And we're both blown away for days.
Yeah, oh, we were.
I'm still blown away.
I know.
Still flying
it's
from
amazing.
That music.
Yeah.
So... what is it? Best You Is My Woman? I'm not going to sing it. All right. Okay. I'm stopping that right here. But you look lovely today, darling.
Thank
and I just
you.
Saw you a few days ago. I see
I
Jamie constantly. Every time I go to something, there you are.
All these happening events.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At TechServe. That was interesting.
It was interesting. Yeah. We got to see three prominent editors talk about the integration of technology in their work, and it was really interesting, and they showed clips from their films, and also it was just a great networking event. I ran into people I knew and kind of chatted with them about what they're up to, and that's always good.
Well, that's one of the things that Manhattan Edit Workshop does. That
yeah.
is so fabulous, because
oh, yeah.
you went here. How long ago were you
It was 3 years ago, probably, 3.5 years ago. Yeah, and I moved here from Colorado, and I didn't know anything about editing, and I found this class online, and basically...
Did you know you wanted to be an editor?
I worked on a film and said, I love this process, but I would really love to see how it finishes, how it comes together in the end. I worked on set, and then I went home, and I was like, oh, but what about the rest of it? And I worked on graphic design in college, so I knew I liked the integration of computer technology and, you know, an artistic career. So I was like, well, editing could be that. And I did. I went on the Manhattan Edit Workshop's website, and they had all their Artists in Residence series videos.
And what is that for those who would like to immediately tune in?
Yeah.
What is the...
The Artists in Residence, they have
the website.
Oh, it's ManhattanEditWorkshop.com.
Oh, okay.
I think.
That was easy.
I hope it's that. Or MuShop.com, probably. But yeah, they have like an archive of all of their Artists in Residence series who are editors who come into the class, talk to the students. Sometimes they hold like events where they'll go into further detail about their work. And I started watching video after video after video and just thought to myself, like, these people are they're like right up my alley. You know, they love film and filmmaking, but they have this relationship with it that I can relate to. You know, they want to support the director and their vision, and they want to be a part of piecing the story together once it's already been shot, which I was very interested in.
Yeah, and you were a great success story for this school, because the minute you graduated, bam, you were out of the box working.
Yeah, well, I mean, I learned great skills here, and also learned to, like, met a lot of people who really supported me. And my first job was through the Manhattan Edit Workshop. I mean, they don't guarantee you a position when you walk out of here at all, but they say that they are giving you the tools. And then they have, you know, Mandy pages that Josh will send out, or people will contact Josh with jobs, and he'll send them out to some of his students. And so it was that I was on an email list, and I got an offer. So I got the job. I was there for 2 years, and then I went out to freelance and just started picking up work on my own.
And you're working now in an igloo or something?
I'm working in a tent.
A tent?
Yes. I'm working in
a... This is a true story,
I know.
Ladies and gentlemen.
It is a true story. Yeah.
It's a loft.
It's a loft.
In New York. And within this loft, there is an... Igloo? No, a tent.
It's a tent. I wish it was an igloo.
Igloo-like tent facility.
Well, because it's like hard to heat this giant room. So basically my director said, well, let's set up a tent and put some space heaters in. It's very comfortable. You can stand up in it and everything. But I'm editing a feature-length documentary.
On?
on. It's following the campaign in 2010 in California called Proposition 19, which is for legalizing marijuana. So it's essentially...
I'm interested.
Yeah, I know. Who is it, right? But it's a good documentary, I think, because it's just following the people who were involved in really creating this grassroots movement. The proposition actually lost by 3.4%, but it was a great step forward for this cannabis movement and legalizing and the war on, and you know, changing the war on drugs and changing failed policies. And so there's a lot of interesting stuff involved with it. So I've learned a lot, and it's been a huge challenge to edit a feature documentary. You go through just hours and hours and hours of footage and try to weed out something that...
Weed out, yeah.
Yeah, no pun intended. Yeah, so find something that, like, anyone's going to want to watch. Raw footage can be very boring.
Really?
Yeah. So,
but not on the Stephen Hull show, strangely enough.
Yeah, we could just do this all day.
Well, yeah, it's called... This is documentary film. This is... I'm the first take... That's it. This is what you see is what you get on the Stephen Hull show. There's no backstage.
That's right. It.
Just more editing decks in the other room.
Yeah.
But people always want to know, especially, of course, women, what is the situation with women and editing? And to me, looking at it as an objective observer, mm-hmm. it seems pretty equal.
Yeah.
For most fields in film, like, for instance, you know, directing is not so much, women are not so much present, but...
That's true.
Or cinematographers either, or you know, whatever, but editing, there's a balance, isn't there?
There is. There's a lot of men and women. My philosophical interpretation of that would be that, you know, I think women have great intuition, and I think also, you know, the role that I have... that I love is that I'm, again, a support system for a greater creative project. So my goal is to kind of be the muse for the director to get the most out of his vision.
The muse at muse.
Oh, yes. God, I'm full of this today.
Yeah.
I don't know, women in particularly, I think we also have a lot of patience. Again, it takes a lot of patience to do this kind of work. And then, you know, again, I've been to a lot of events where people like to talk about the integration of technology and women being more tech savvy.
Really? You think that's the case?
Yeah, well,
no. I'm not.
No, I don't know necessarily that they're more tech savvy than men, but that's an interest for a lot of women is to, you know, to be in these thriving technological fields as women. Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're just as, you know, capable and knowledgeable and interested is actually the key. I think for a long time people just thought that women weren't as interested in technology. But women were actually the first major players in the editing world because they, you know, I think were...
D.W. Griffith.
Yeah.
Connie Booth.
Yeah, I mean, they worked with their hands and they made great things.
That was the D.W. Griffith's editor was a woman, and so was Cecil B. DeMille's.
Yeah, I know. Lovely. And, you know, Martin Scorsese, now we have
Thelma
Schoonmaker. And she is...
The editing goddess. Thelma, be on my show, Thelma. We talk about you all the time, but, you know.
Yeah, but she really is, I mean, she is the ideal woman in this industry.
She was interviewed by... my friend David Poland on his website DP30, she got her to talk for 30 minutes. It was fascinating.
Oh my God.
And he did, one of the questions he asked her was, do you want to work for anybody else? Do you want to do it? Yeah. She said no.
Well, that's what's so great about it is, and I admire that, is it, I feel like that's exactly what happens is you end up building these relationships that you love so much.
We're talking about Martin Scorsese and Thelma Schoonmaker.
And they just work, And, you know, I can guarantee you that he relies on her for a lot.
Totally.
Like,
oh,
and
my
he
God,
trusts
yeah.
her, and they have a really safe relationship. I mean, I don't know. I'm guessing. But, you know, I've had
for years,
little tastes of
40
that
years or something. Yeah.
And when you have it and it's good, you keep stick with it.
Yeah. And she's spoiled, Thelma. She just doesn't want to work with anybody else. And she was married to
Michael Powell. Yeah.
Oh my God.
You know, I went to a film forum and saw her speak. She was showing the Red Shoes, which Michael Powell did, and her and Martin and their organization Martin. Like, I just, you know, he's
Marty.
My
it's
buddy.
Marty. Yeah, it's Marty. We have to say Marty.
All right. Yeah, they had done the restoration for the film, and so brought out the beautiful colors in it again, and they screened it. It was so cool. And of course, afterwards, I was like, you know, following her around. I didn't actually get to talk to her, but.
Well, maybe she's watching the Stephen Holt show today, and the next thing you'll know, you'll be working with Thelma.
Oh, sure.
We all want to work with Thelma in one form or another, but it was just fascinating, because she, did you see Hugo? Have you seen it?
Yeah.
When she was talking, again, to my friend David Pola, not to me, but she was going on and on about her husband, and about what happened to him in his career. And I often felt, listening to that, that having just seen Hugo, that actually that was the subtext of that movie, was the story of Michael Powell.
Interesting.
And how he became a forgotten filmmaker in his lifetime. And,
yeah, that's very interesting.
And how tragic that was.
Yeah, it was a great, you know, kind of homage to filmmaking. Beautiful movie.
Yeah, yeah. How did you, what did you think of the editing?
Yeah, the editing was great.
She may win another Oscar. She may have already won her fourth Oscar by the time you see this.
No kidding. Well, and it's flawless. I think, you know, when it's good editing, you just don't notice it. It just works, you know, unless it's highly stylized.
Yes,
otherwise, it's
point.
Just that it you don't notice it. We're the secret people behind the scenes just making it work, you know.
And it has to be an editor, you really have to have a different kind of personality.
Yeah.
Than, like, me, type A. You have to be. I could never be an editor. I could, no patience.
Yeah, we sit in dark rooms for long hours.
Yes. I do that anyway with my writing my blog and everything, keeping everything up to date on YouTube, but, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a lot. It's a lot. It does take a different personality, yeah. But it's so creative, and you're so sad. You can be so satisfied with a product when you're finished.
And you feel that way now with that?
Well, I'm getting there. Yeah.
You were working till 5 a.m. or something,
well,
and then
I just did it.
And then just said, "That's it. I can't do it. I'm doing the Stephen Holt show now. Okay, bye."
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I'm getting there. I think it's a long process to do a feature, and but
how many months now?
Well, I've been on it for about 4 months, which I think in the grand scheme of things, especially for a documentary, is not long. But I could probably chisel away at this thing for another year. I just don't have that kind of time. We're on the time schedule of the election in 2012 and trying to use this film as a Kickstarter.
And it's 2012 now.
And it is 2012, so I have, you know, what is it, 8 months until I gotta get this thing out. So I'll get it out soon, I think in the next couple months.
But it's always wonderfully charming to bump into you.
Yes.
Wherever we are, go to the theater, Porgy and Bess, Broadway. You
it's
know,
so
there
great.
She is, TechServe. She could cut. This girl covers it, ladies and gentlemen. And here we are at the Manhattan Edit Workshop, a very illustrious graduate. Mm. And thank you so much, Jamie Unruh,
well,
for coming
in
today.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, it's great to see you. Thanks for being involved with the editing community. I love
it. Oh, thank you.
He's taken on this editing world, and I love it.
I love it, too, because you know they're not actors. It's a change for me. It's a huge change, you know.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it's a completely different kind of personality that goes into pursues editing, and I just love it because it's different, you know, and it's special and it's fabulous, and editing is so important. Editors spend more time on a project and a film that you all enjoy, you know, watching probably more than almost any other person involved with it. And they don't get the credit they deserve, but I'm giving the credit where credit is due today.
Oh, thank you.
To Jamie Unruh here at the wonderful Manhattan Edit Workshop. So, have a fabulous.
Bye.